And I think my story starts actually at the very trickle of the beginning of the flow game. And like Tuka said, we didn't know it was would end up being a game. But a couple of you mentioned a big leap, and I think we took a fairly big leap in 91. We started our company, and we moved from Copenhagen to where we live now in Silkeborg. And we started our business, our business at the same time. So it was kind of a big change, and we didn't know how it would work out. And the one thing was that I don't think either of us had thought we would actually run a company or do a business. I come from an academic background, and I'm trained as an architect myself. I don't think I ever had thought to have my own company. But circumstances of life sometimes guide you in different directions, and here we were, and had started our company Interchange. And because we knew, and I was very taken aback and surprised by how much admin and how many things you needed to take, to kind of decisions you needed to make ongoing. I wasn't prepared for it at all. I hardly knew what an invoice was. So it was really like a quick learning curve. And I think we both felt we needed a little bit more knowledge about how you actually run a company. So we went to a course about entrepreneurship. And this was like happening once a week in the evenings. And the way it usually happens in Denmark is it's free, but you work with volunteers. So you have a lawyer come in, and you have somebody who understands finances come in and give their input and give their knowledge. So the first meeting we attended was a lawyer, actually, that came and talked about how you found a business. But he also spent a lot of time talking about how you close a business. Mm. How you go bankrupt? If you go bankrupt, what do you need to do? And here we were wanting to learn how you run a business, and we were meeting this first introduction to how you close a business. It wasn't really what we were needing to hear at that moment. And nothing wrong with that. That's good knowledge to have too. But we just after, and then we heard about finances. We heard about this, but nobody prepared us for the internal journey of leadership that you needed to take as an entrepreneur. So we were in a discussion that, together with some of our other colleagues, that there probably would be a better way of doing this, because everybody prepared us for the outward journey, but nobody prepared us for the inward journey, for the internal journey of personal leadership. So we met with, as we moved to Silkeborg, we kind of met a new network of people, and Tuka got quickly engaged with the Chaos Baylor University. It's a very progressive leadership academy type of thing for students in Aarhus, which is a city nearby. And there was another person called Finn Woltofte, who actually was the third person who kind of shaped the World Cafe. Juanita and David have been very instrumental in it, but Finn Woltofte was the third person who actually put it into some kind of shape and form. He was a very progressive guy, and Tuka and him met up, and he was in a similar situation. He had a small business and small company, and we got into this conversation. So we started to meet. Once a month, we took a whole day off to just talk about personal leadership and to how you could do an entrepreneurial training in a different way and stuff like that. We didn't have any fixed agenda. We had set up these meetings, and they were quality time for us. So it was really like business time, whole 8 hours in a day, and we sat in a circle and had conversations. And quite quickly we saw that it would be interesting to have a few other voices and perspectives in the circle. So we invited our young colleague, Jan Hein, who we had met in a training that we did, and spotted potential in him as a very young man. And he had come up out when we did jobs in our company. He came with us, and he learned quicker by just being around and like apprenticing with us. And he was invited into the conversation, and he explained what he had felt coming out to work with us. He said it was like a flow enhancer. Mm. It enhanced his own flow. It's like when you have on the lake, you have bigger ships that go, the canoes always go into slipstream because it kind of pulls them along. So it was that kind of feeling, or as Jan would say, beam me up, Scotty, experience. So here we were in this conversation and just not having any particular fixed agenda, and slowly we started to ask who else could be here. And we invited a Swedish guy called Jack Skoe. He had worked for Scandinavian Airline Systems when they did a big turnaround in the 80s. And we invited a lawyer who was a local in Aarhus region. And we invited, and she was also working with social innovation. And we invited a young student who was also Mikkel, who was also Toke's nephew. So we had a diversity of skills and diversity of ages and genders in the room. And
Wufa.
And Wufa Rian, of course, who was Moroccan.
Second generation Muslim Moroccan chaos pilot. His father was the
imam
of Aarhus.
Uh-huh.
A wicked...
wicked lady, yeah. So here we were, eight people, having these conversations, and one of the meetings Jack took, he was working as a facilitator, and he was working together with graphic facilitators and using graphic templates to co-facilitate his processes. And so he took all the material we had created in one meeting, all the notes, and sent it up to his graphic facilitator in Stockholm. And for the next meeting, he came back with a graphic rendering of our notes. And when he rolled it out, it was like, I still remember it, I probably have a copy of it. It was like a racetrack with a lot of symbols and stuff like that. And when he rolled that visual rendering out, we looked at it and we just all said, this is a board game. So it is a process, but we realized it was a board game. For me, I think this was a really pivotal moment in our conversations. But we had a long lead-in time without any fixed agenda, time agenda. Mm-hmm. So like 6 months or something like that. But at that moment, we just knew it was a board game. And at that moment, that pivotal change that Toke already mentioned happened. Instead of trying to do unto others, entrepreneurial training unto others, we asked what would be fun for ourselves. And we started to brainstorm what kind of questions and dilemmas were we sitting in, what kind of answers would we looking for. And so we started to totally energetic brainstorm, and we started to talk. Then it was almost like the game came out like this, plop. And then we also realized it could be nice with some images here, because she had used some symbols. And so Mikkel and I took some magazines that Finn had with all kinds of weird pictures, all kinds of really weird pictures. You had a huge hand suspending a man in the air, and you had people in scrubs. The picture was taken from down here, and there were seven people with scrubs looking down at you. You were on the operating table, and pictures like this that we picked all the pictures that didn't have a clear kind of, that made you think a little bit, oh, what's this? And kind of made it trigger something. Then in that same creative kind of brainstorm, somebody mentioned, we need a structure for all this. What could be a good structure? And somebody had heard about the medicine wheel. And I had also met the medicine wheel in terms of learning about open space at Harris and Owen. Sometimes uses the medicine wheel to conclude an open space and do a collective reflection. So we knew very little about the First Nation tradition, but we felt it was a wise structure. And we have a very simplified version of that wise structure, and it's no disrespect at all. It's really with a lot of reverence we picked up that structure and said this could be a beautiful structure to structure the flow game. So the medicine wheel became like the structure where we could put the questions in the different directions. And we realized it also had, there were like four directions of leadership, which is having the courage to break new ground, and then also having the community that you care about, that to align with, and then having the vision to and the overview, but also having the action and methodical doing. So the this medicine wheel gave us that structure where we could organize things. The first version of the game was extremely complicated. We had two different dice, and of course the dice had six directions, so we had first, I don't even remember how it was, we had sun, moon, and stars, and we had all kinds of directions, so it was extremely complicated. And the first prototype was just like a watercolor drawing and some stuff that we had made. And then at some point, Tuke and Jan and I were in Pema Ling in this California?
California, yeah? By Santa Cruz.
Yeah, Santa Cruz, yeah. And doing a process for the pioneers of change. And at the end of that process, we invited whoever wanted to come and test this game. So we had three parallel games hosted by Tuke, Jan, and myself. And we realized after the game, this game is too complicated. We need to simplify it. So we made a little simpler version, and that is the basis of the version we have today. Our group of eight, three of the people are not using the flow game at all. They were part of creating it, and they were midwifing it together with us. Wolfa and Finn did use the flow game and offered it out and kind of developed their own visual version of it. And Jan and Tuke and I, we took the same flow game and kind of evolved our visual version of it. So they're slightly, the principles are the same, even though they are slightly different. And Finn Wolthofter unfortunately died some years ago, 10 years ago or something. And I think Wofa is still using the flow game. We haven't met since then. Actually, this group of eight, once we had created the flow game, we didn't meet again until several years later when we called everybody together to then compare how had we used it, what had happened, and so forth. So, but we had an email that was the last thing that we shared. It was like a little compact, compassionate pact of how we wanted to hold the flow game and how we wanted to pass it on. And I still remember Finn's words. He said, this is not really a board game. It is a process. The board game is like the container for it. And the host and the board game are containers for the process, but it is a process. Somehow the elements of the flow game, which I'm sure we'll talk more about in the when we go to a separate groups, somehow there's so many elements that that combine together into the flow game that when it works at best, there is the magic in the middle that comes out from the wisdom of the people and the serendipity of the game and the playfulness of the game. So there's so many elements that bring that possibility together. So for me, the main things from this is I remember back with pleasure the quality time of sitting and just having conversations without a specific fixed agenda. But we had a clear purpose. It was about personal leadership. That was the thing in circle. And then allowing that viscose, that fat koiros time, to then crystallize suddenly into something that we all saw together. And for me also the pivotal moment when we stopped trying to do something for other people but just really looked at ourselves was really a change in that game for me. So there are many versions of the game after that, and you will have version 2.0, I think, you will receive. Or is it 3.0? I'm not sure.
One more thing about the circle of bitwise and some of the principles that crystallized as we worked and somehow they have stayed with us. The notion of working and being worked by an oak tree and not by a speedy process. And somehow, though we were eight completely different people and in different contexts, we somehow aligned in the principle that we wouldn't make any serious decisions about moving forward unless it had a natural flow. So if we would begin to argue about something, we would say, let's formulate that as a question and bring it to next time we meet, and then we have slept on it, and we trust that in the meantime, the unfolding of our lives would have brought us to a clarity from which we could then make a decision. So the timing of and how we made decisions, we practiced and learned forth in that year. One of those decisions was who could host this game. So we begin with, we made then a decision in the end of our pregnancy time there, and that we would be the only people to host the game. Those eight of us, if we wanted to. Then three decided not to, one went to the ancestors, and Wolfer hosted for a few games, and then her life went on. And then we picked it up, and we would not bind each other to either that, if, you know, to any strict rules, but that we would begin to train other people when the world and the game would show us. 2 years later, some of our colleagues came and said, you know, we would like to host this game too. And so we began to listen. And we then played the game on that request. And then we began to train people. And now, with this training, we will be more than 200 in the world.